अस्सलाम वालेकुम, वेलकम टू लेक्चर 24 ऑफ डेटा माइनिंग। सो टुडे वी विल कंटिन्यू विद आवर डिस्कशन ऑन डिसीजन ट्रीज एंड इन पर्टिकुलर वी विल टॉक अबाउट रैंडम फॉरेस्ट विच इज एन एनसेंबल अप्रोच यूजिंग डिसीजन ट्रीज। एंड आफ्टर दैट वी विल टॉक अबाउट टेम्पोरल डेटा माइनिंग। And temporal data mining, of course, deals with data that has an element of time. Many of the techniques for temporal data mining would be very similar to the techniques that we have already studied. But of course, temporal data have the special characteristics of having time. And so the pre-processing and formulation of the problem might be slightly different. So that would be the learning per se that we'll be deriving when we discuss temporal data mining. And we'll also briefly talk about spatial temporal data mining as well. So that would consume our next 2-3 lectures in this course. So today, of course, we will talk about decision trees and random forest. And I do not plan to discuss any other major classification algorithm. So that is the idea for today and the next 2-3 lectures. So are there any questions? Excuse me. Okay, any questions? So we were talking about decision trees last time, and we had discussed the entire decision tree algorithm, which is a information theoretic classifier, and the algorithm itself is a divide and conquer recursive as well as greedy algorithm. It builds a tree starting from the simplest tree, which is just one node, and then grows the tree depth wise. Actually, it grows the tree breadth-wise. It goes from one node, then fills in the nodes at the next level, meaning that fills in the entire breadth at the next level, and then goes to the next level, fills in the entire breadth until we reach a leaf node. And the decision that we base at each of those nodes is decided by a splitting criterion. And we talked about a number of splitting criterions. You can use entropy or information gain. You can use information gain ratio, and you can also use Gini index. So a decision tree is trained over a training data set. And once you're building the tree and you reach a node where the data set becomes pure, meaning that, let's say if you have a two-class problem, let's say you have 0 and 1 as the class labels. But let's say if you have a split that reaches a particular leaf node and all the points belong to one class. Let's say they belong to class one. Let's say 15 belong to class one. So this is an example of a pure leaf node. So, and the label that we will attach to this leaf node is, of course, 1. The label here is 1. And the confidence, of course, is 100%. Okay? But in many real-world applications, whenever you reach a leaf node or whenever you stop and make and do not grow the tree any further, you have to end it with a leaf node. And the leaf node has the label assigned to it. So it might happen that the data set that reaches that leaf node is not entirely pure. So for example, you might have a scenario like this. Let's say for a particular leaf node, you have, let's say, 5 belonging to class 0, and 20 belonging to class 1. So in this case, it is not entirely pure, but we will still need to assign some label to it. So we usually use the majority vote. So label would be 1, because 20 examples belong to class 1 and only 5 examples belong to class 0. Of course, if you want to attach a probability or confidence with this label, you can also do that. So the confidence, of course, would be 20 divided by 25. Okay? So 0.8 or 80%. So this is how you actually then label the leaf nodes of a decision tree. The ideal scenario, of course, is the data that reaches a leaf node is pure. It belongs to only one class and all the other class examples do not exist at that particular level or leaf node. In that case, there is no ambiguity. You label that leaf node with the examples belonging to the class that reaches that node. But in many other practical situations, the data that reaches a particular leaf node may not be entirely pure. They might belong to multiple classes. So usually we label that leaf node with the majority examples that reach that particular leaf node. And if you want to attach a confidence with it, you can do so as well. Okay. So we ended last lecture while we were talking about overfitting. So overfitting is a problem in decision tree. It is a problem in any supervised machine learning approach, but it is also a problem in decision tree. And we talked about two general approaches for addressing overfitting. And one way of quantifying the potential for overfitting is the number of nodes in a decision tree. If a decision tree has more nodes, we say that that decision tree is more expressive, more complex, and is likely to overfit. So we would like decision trees that are simpler, that have fewer nodes. To achieve those, we can do early stopping. We talked about this last time. Early stopping means that you stop growing the tree. Even though you might not have reached a pure data split, you stop growing the tree as long as the entropy is less than some threshold. So that is early stopping. The other approaches are post-pruning. You stop growing the tree in the usual way using some stopping criteria like the entropy at the split is less than some threshold. Once the tree is fully built, then you kind of remove or move the tree simpler or prune the tree. There are actually a number of approaches here, but the approach that we talked about specifically was subtree post-pruning, which was basically selecting from the leaf nodes, selecting nodes to delete. So once you delete a node, you delete the entire tree below it. And once you have deleted that node, you check the error of the resulting tree on the test set or validation set. If the error has reduced, then this means that this removal is beneficial. You will try all such other possible removals. The removal that gives you the highest reduction in error would be selected greedily. And then you repeat until you do not get any reduction in error after removal. So in other words, you build the tree completely and then try to make it simpler by removing nodes, of course, from the leaf from the bottom. There is another approach, rule post-pruning, but we won't talk about that. But from this, I would just want to highlight one key characteristics or positive characteristic of decision trees. So a decision tree is very easy to explain to laymen. So a decision tree, essentially, if you follow a path from the leaf node to the root node, it is essentially a rule. So let me give an example. We did a data set of three. A is equal to 1 and B is equal to, let's say, 0. Let's say after this, you have reached a leaf node, then you have label is equal to 0. So if you follow each path from a particular leaf node to the root node, you can extract a rule like this. In this case, the leaf node is label 0. And then the path, first path is, let's say, B, a decision on B, and then a decision on A. So a decision tree essentially is thus a set of such rules. So this is maybe one path, there might be other paths as well. So if you want to explain the decision of your classifier, you can easily explain it by using such a rule. So you can explain why I said that this particular example is class 0. You can say because A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 0. And this is a rule that is part of the decision tree. Okay. So this is a very powerful positive trait for decision trees. And this is as opposed to, for example, let's say you're using a neural network. Neural network is more or less a black box. You cannot explain the decision of a neural network to even more sophisticated and knowledgeable people, let alone to a layman. But a decision tree's decision can be easily communicated to a layman because it is like a rule. You make a decision on one attribute, then another attribute, combine all those. If all of that is true, then you have the right-hand side, which is a label. Okay. So that brings us to the end of the standard decision tree learning algorithm. If you look at the literature, you will see many, you can say, fancy names for decision tree learning algorithms. One of the earliest algorithms that uses entropy was called ID3, inductive dichotomy 3. And then there are also other names like C4.5 and then J, Java-based 4.8, and then there are others as well. So all of these algorithms have slight variations. There's also another algorithm called, for example, CART, classification and regression trees. So all of them have slight variations. We have discussed most of those variations in the generic discussion that we have done in this course. So we have used information gain. We have used information gain ratio. We have also talked about Gini index, which is used in, for example, CART. Okay. We have also talked about some ways of handling overfitting, and some of these earlier techniques, ID3 and C4.5, vary by the way in which they handle overfitting. So I'm just mentioning this so that you know that these are some names that are used for decision trees. All right, so now let's talk about another decision tree variant, or you can say approach, which is commonly known by the name random forest. And random forest, of course, is becoming more popular nowadays. And one of the main strengths and one of the reasons for the popularity of random forest. So random forest is that it manages overfitting well. So one of the criticisms for decision trees were it tend to overfit the data. It would learn even randomness in the data, learn even noise in the data. The tree would become very dense, very deep with many nodes, and even noisy information in the data would also be learned. So to counter that, this whole idea of random forest became popular. And as the name suggests, there is a lot of randomness introduced in the process. And through randomness, the issues of overfitting are handled. So let's see this. So one of the other main idea behind random forest is, of course, one is random. The other is it's basically an ensemble method. So what is an ensemble method? The ensemble methods are methods that use multiple classifiers, you can say at the same time. So instead of building one model or one classifier, you build multiple models. And at prediction time, you use all of those models together so as to ensure that your final results are robust, final predictions are robust and less prone to errors due to overfitting. So this is a general concept in machine learning of using multiple models. And random forest is a particular example that uses multiple trees for classification. Okay, so now the process is fairly easy. So I'll discuss this in the next 10 minutes, I think. So the basic random forest has two ideas. One is bootstrap aggregation, and I'll talk about this also later, which is sometimes also called bagging. And this is, by the way, a general method for building multiple models. Ensemble method is a part of an ensemble method. And the next is basically feature subspace randomization. Okay. So these are the two main ideas. So let's discuss what those ideas are. So to learn any classifier, we have a training data, right? So let's say we have a training data D. Okay. So of course, as we mentioned, D could be xi, yi, I is equal to 1 to n. Okay, so n examples in the training data, x are the features, y is the label. Okay. So bootstrap aggregation is you generate multiple samples with replacement from this data set. Okay. So generate multiple samples from D using random sampling with replacement. Okay. So let's say D was our original. Data, okay. And its size kya tha? Size was n. So you basically sample this data set with replacement and generate additional samples d1 to whatever, let's say, you can say dm. Usually m is large. Depending on, of course, on your data set, but M can easily be hundreds of samples. So M is number of samples, of course. ठीक है. सो एम इज द नंबर ऑफ सैंपल्स, सो यू जनरेट हंड्रेड्स ऑफ सैंपल्स एंड यू देन बिल्ड योर डिसीजन ट्री ऑन ईच ऑफ दोज हंड्रेड सैंपल्स. सो इन एसेंस एट द एंड ऑफ द डे यू देन हैव एम डिसीजन ट्रीज, डी टी वन, डी टी एम. ठीक है. सो नाउ वी हैव एम डिसीजन ट्रीज. ईच ऑफ देम इज लर्नड यूजिंग वट एवर टेक्निक दैट यू आर यूजिंग. लेट्स से यू आर यूजिंग एंट्रोपी एंड और लेट्स से यू आर यूजिंग द ID3 algorithm. So you can use any of those techniques to build a tree, but built on each of those samples, and those samples will be slightly different from the original sample, because the original sample was D, and we are generating those additional samples by random sampling with replacement. Okay, and those samples are also of the same size n. So you do sample the original data set n times. So this is called bootstrap aggregation or bootstrapping as well as bagging. So you now have m decision trees, not one. Now you have m decision trees, which are, as I said, dozens or hundreds of decision trees. So given any new example x, let's say, you will get the prediction. So for x, obtain prediction from all the decision trees D1 to DTM. ठीक है. And choose the majority decision. ठीक है. Again, the majority vote concept is used. So you are now making a decision for a particular example X using not one classifier or one decision tree, but m decision trees, and you will select as the best label or decision for this x based on the majority vote, the number, the label that is most commonly outputted or predicted by those m classifiers. And each of those m classifiers, as I mentioned earlier, is built on a bootstrap aggregate or bagged examples of the original data set. Okay, so this brings in some randomness, and then of course you have multiple decision trees, and the final prediction is based on all of them, and you're using of course the majority vote. So this is the bagging idea, but this is not all. Usually most random forests implement the other idea also, which, as I said, was feature subspace okay, there is a slight confusion in my mind, so I'm just trying to resolve that. Randomization. All right. Okay, so in addition to bagging, the other approach, which is also included in most random forest implementations, is that instead of building each of those decision trees, so there are m decision trees that we want to build. Now each of those is now developed from a subset of the features. ठीक है. So let's say हमारे पास जो x था, of course x in general is a vector. Let's say there are notation मैंने थोड़ी सी change कर दी, ऊपर m use कर लिया. So let's say there are k features, ठीक है, in all. So instead of using all those k features and deciding wish to select for each of those decision trees, for each of those samples, we randomly select, usually in the literature, it is written as SQRT, K features. So let's maybe give an example. Let's say I have 16 features originally. So of course, SQRT of 16 is equal to 4. So what does this mean? Meaning that we will select out of those 16. So let's say we are building decision tree one. I will randomly select 4 features / attributes from the 16 that I have. And then build tree using these 4 features only. So in other words, we are kind of, if you have a data set where columns are features, so each tree is only using a subset of those columns. And that septa number of columns, of course, this is a kind of heuristic, is you can use the square root of the total number of features, which in this case is 4. And these 4 that are selected randomly for each. So DT1 ke liye, let's say maybe 1, 5, 7, or 9 select ho jayenge. DT2 ke liye, let's say 2, 5, 12, and 16 select ho sakte hain, and so on. Done randomly, uniform randomly. And then you choose your tree. Of course, now each of these trees would be smaller, because ab sirf 4 nodes ka tree maximum ban sakta hai. Pehle, of course, tree 16 ka tha. Of course, depth ki main baat kar raha hun. Of course, total number of nodes might be larger. So maximum depth of a tree would now be 4. In the previous case, it would be 16. So simpler trees banenge. And then, of course, this decision is also done randomly. So, and then at the end, it's the same approach. The final decision is made by majority vote. So most implementations of random forest would have both of these steps. The first is generate multiple samples with displacement. And then build a tree using subsets of the total feature set for each sample. And then make a final decision for any new example based on the decisions of all of those trees. And then the decision, of course, is based on the majority decision of all of those trees. So that essentially is basically random forest. The underlying approach for selecting a particular node is the same as we discussed before. It could be entropy, information gain ratio, Gini index, and so on. And the procedure is also the same. You greedily select one node, then the nodes at the next level, then the nodes at the next level. But now we have randomized it, both the data as well as the features. So data randomization bhi hai, feature randomization bhi hai. So there are a few other extensions or variations to this. Very quickly, I'll just mention a name. So there's also a tree called extra tree, which basically stands for, or short for, random trees. So this is very similar to random forest that we have discussed previously. One of the difference that they make is they don't really use a subset or they don't limit their decision to a subset. They take the whole feature set. Let's say my 16 features say, but from these 16 features, they select using the distribution of whatever measure that you're using, for example, information gain. Select based on the distribution of the information gain ratio. So let's say, again, let's take an example, A, B, C tha aapke paas option. So let's say information gain of A jo tha, koi value hai, let's say 0.2, information gain of B is, let's say, 2, information gain of C, let's say, is equal to, let's say, 1.5. So of course, if you use greedy selection, you will choose B because its information gain sabse zyada hai. But now in extremely random trees, extra trees, you will use this distribution of information gain and then sample randomly to select the tree. So there is a probability that you will not choose B. Of course, the chance for selecting B is higher because iski probability, iske score zyada, iske probability bhi zyada hogi. Okay? Of course, you can normalize this to probability using something like a softmax. ठीक है तो इसका चांस सिलेक्शन का ज्यादा है बट देर इज ऑलवेज ए प्रोबेबिलिटी दैट मे बी यू सिलेक्ट ए और यू मे बी यू सिलेक्ट सी बट ऑब्वियसली उसका चांस कम होगा बट देयर स्टिल अ चांस एंड सिंस यू डू दिस रैंडमली ओवर लेट्स से हंड्रेड्स ऑफ सैंपल्स सो यू विल माइट गेट सम वेरिएशंस सो दीज ट्रीज आर कॉल्ड एक्सट्रीमली रैंडम ट्रीज और एक्स्ट्रा ट्रीज And I would say that extra trees and random forests are quite common in practice, even today, in the you can say in the modern age of neural networks, decision trees, especially random forests and extremely random trees, are quite popular in practice in the industry. So, and one of the reasoning for that is, especially for random forest and extra trees, they do good. Give performance, good performances. And the second reason is, of course, they are somewhat easier to explain to non-technical people, to laymen. There are some other ensemble methods using trees that involve a bit more mathematics. I will just mention their name and we won't discuss that. One is called the gradient boosted trees. So you might see this name in the literature or in the APIs that you are using for machine learning. So these are also trees. In this case, you have a more sophisticated way of selecting the decisions for each node. So you typically have some optimization problem that you're solving that is more sophisticated than the greedy selection that you use in most typical decision trees that we have seen so far. Okay. So modern day random forest, extra trees, and gradient boosted trees are quite popular. Okay, so that basically brings us to the end of decision trees and also probably classification. I do not plan to cover some of the other classification techniques, although we did mention neural networks previously. So most neural network architectures are relatively simpler, similar to the autoencoder that we talked about when we discussed dimensionality reduction and outlier analysis. So neural networks, such straightforward neural network can also be used for classification, and they're also quite popular in practice nowadays. So any questions so far?
Sir, 16 features under root layer 4 aaya hai, toh possible trees 4 banenge ya mazid ban sakte hain? Matlab feature repeat ho sakte hain dusre trees mein?
Haan ji, bilkul ho sakte hain.
Toh hum kitne trees banate hain phir isme? Ye toh koi stopping, matlab 16 features hai, toh agar main repeat bhi karta rahunga toh kitne banenge trees? Koi threshold ya kuch hai iska?
उसमें एक्चुअली ना यू आर मिक्सिंग टू थिंग्स. द नंबर ऑफ ट्रीज इज इक्वल टू द नंबर ऑफ सैंपल दैट वी हैव क्रिएटेड, द एम दैट आई मेंशन्ड. ठीक है, सो एम लेट्स से मेरे पास 100 है, आई विल क्रिएट 100 ट्रीज. सो एम इज द नंबर ऑफ सैंपल दैट आई हैव क्रिएटेड फ्रॉम द ओरिजिनल डेटा सेट बाय रैंडम सैम्पलिंग विद रिप्लेसमेंट. ठीक है, so which means that I'll create 100 trees. For any particular tree, let's say DTI, okay, which is based on some particular sampler, let's sample DI, okay, it will be built on this sample DI, okay, I will randomly select wage of 4, let's say 16th, na, SQRT 16 features, which is of course 4. So once you have, for this particular case, आप इन्हीं 4 में से आप decide करेंगे कि आपका tree का पहला root node क्या होगा, next level पे node दूसरे कौन से होंगे, and that's it. 4 consume कर लिए तो your tree would stop. For any other decision tree, let's say DJ के लिए, उसके लिए फिर randomly आप कोई 4 select करेंगे. It might happen कि वो 4 उसमें से कोई आ जाए, कोई नहीं आए. So do you get this point?
Okay, yes. Yes, thank you.
So if you compare two trees, let's say main kehta hu DT10 hai aur DT20 hai, zaruri nahi hai ki unme jo nodes DT10 mein jo nodes hain, jo features hain, wo wahi honge jo DT20 mein honge. But kuch overlap bhi ho sakte hain because randomly humne wo char choose kiya na. So there could be an overlap and there could be no overlap. It's all based on randomness. Any other question? Okay, the next topic that I kind of decided for this course is basically temporal data mining, and part of it we'll also talk about because it's not much different, spatio temporal data mining. So some of the topic that I am choosing for this course is based on that understanding that these topics are probably not covered in the other related courses that we offer at LUMS. For example, I know for sure decision trees are not discussed in the machine learning course, even though it's a reasonably popular technique in practice in the industry. And similarly, I don't think temporal data mining in some detail is discussed in any other course, except of course the NLP course, which is more focused on discrete temporal or discrete sequences. But here, the ideas would be somewhat similar, but here we can also have continuous values as well. Okay. So first of all, just to motivate why temporal data mining, I would say that time is always an attribute in all our recordings. It is usually up to us that we choose to ignore it. So if there was no time, obviously you wouldn't have any data. Or sometimes I think there is a saying from Einstein, I said, if there was no time, then everything would have occurred at the same all the events would be just one event. Because time, it is time that causes events to be distinguished one from the other. Okay? So everything that we see, we do, we record has an time attached with it. And with the same token, I would say that space is also attached with it. So time and space are always attributes, but sometimes we choose to ignore them. Okay? And that was most of the scenarios that we have studied so far. Okay? And so usually we distinguish our features / attributes into two. We say that we have what is known as contextual attributes, and then we have behavioral attributes. Okay? So behavioral attributes are usually the ones of interest, although contextual attributes are also of interest, but usually in most application, behavioral attributes are more interest. But contextual attributes actually kind of contextualize those behavioral attributes. So just to give an example, so let's say we have temperature recordings. Okay? So you have an attribute A and you have an attribute B. Attribute A is time. So let's say 12 is the attribute value A, and then you have, let's say, temperature 25. And then let's say you have 13, you have temperature 26. Let's say you have 14, and then let's say you have 25, and so on. So this attribute A is actually a contextual attribute, and the behavioral attribute is B, which is temperature. So A is time, which is contextual, and B is temperature, which is behavioral. Okay? So, and of course, let's say these recordings are made by sensors, and sensors may be placed at different places. So you might have some spatial attribute as well. Let's say A is time, let's say B is, let's say, X coordinate, C is Y coordinate, or where the sensor is placed. Let's say D is temperature. Let's say there might be multiple sensing at the same point. E is, let's say, pressure. And F, let's say, is, let's say, so the humidity. So you can have this as well. Here now, the contextual attributes are multivariate. So both contextual and behavioral attributes are multiple. So in other words, you can call them multivariate if you use the terminology of statistics, or you can call them multi-dimensional, which is more common in databases, and so on. Okay? But if it is not explicitly mentioned, when something is said that is univariate or multivariate, when it is not explicitly mentioned contextual or behavioral, then it is usually assumed to be behavioral. So when we say that we have a multi-variate temporal data, it means that the behavioral attributes are more than one. Okay? So you can even think of temporal data as bigger things as well. For example, let's say आपके पास security camera है. So security camera get A is time and B is a video frame at that particular time. So of course, B is not just one value. It's a whole data structure. And of course, if it's a video or image, then it's a 2D data structure with values. It could be any other data structure. So that B, it could be a scalar. So behavioral, so attributes can be scalar, multi-dimensional, which you can say is vectors. They could be matrices. They could be graphs. They could be anything else. ठीक है, complex structure भी हो सकता है. ठीक है. So this is what a spatial temporal data looks like. But there is a slight further categorization, and this is especially for the case of behavioral attributes. ठीक है, if the behavioral attributes are continuous, and the contextual attribute is time, then you call this a time series data. ठीक है, so if the behavioral attributes are discrete, and of course the contextual attribute time, then we call this as sequence data. So when we say sequence, usually we are talking about behavioral attributes that are discrete. Like for example, you can even think of the DNA sequence. So DNA sequence, it has the base pairs A, T, D, iski combination hoti hai. So this is a sequence. Theek hai? Discrete hai. You can even think of natural language as a discrete sequence or sequence data, because words hain. I study at LUMS, for example, the sequence of characters. So this is also sequence data. While of course time series data is, let's say, temperature recordings are 25 25 25.5 25 26 and so on. So this would be a time series data. Sequence is a sequence of discrete values. ठीक है, within the sequence data, sometimes we also call some, if the sequence data is univariate and there is no notion of time but just an order, we still call it sequence data. But sometimes if it is univariate, we can also call it a string. ठीक है, so for example, live is a string because there is a notion of order, live. ठीक है, and there isn't any explicit notion of time, but order hai. It is sequence data, but more specifically in this case it's a string. Discrete hai, ordered hai, so it's like a string. And of course it's univariate, we are talking about just one sequence. By the way, some of the content that I'm going to cover, I would say most of the content that I'm going to cover, most of it would be a kind of overview, would be from chapter 14 of the book called Data Mining, the textbook by Agarwal. So I do have a copy of this, and I will make the chapter available to you on LMS. Okay. But you have to use it for personal use only. Okay. So I'll make it available on LMS, and you have to use it for personal purposes only. Okay. All right. And I think I've already posted this on LMS resources, so you can check it out. All right, so we were talking about the notion of a temporal data. We talked about time series data. We talked about sequence data. And a specific specialization of sequence data is a string. Okay. And we also made distinction between contextual attributes and behavioral attributes. So contextual attribute kind of define the context for the behavioral attribute. And they typically include time and some space information like X coordinate, Y coordinate, latitude, longitude, and so on. Okay. Sometimes, and especially this is for spatial data mining, space information is actually of importance, and we put that into behavioral attributes. So for example, let's say you have let's say you're talking about athletics, and you are kind of monitoring performance of various athletes over a track. The track is of fixed length, but of course, different people would follow that track at different speeds, at different paces. Okay. And they might follow different lanes of the track. What you're only interested in is maybe A, which is time. And then you're also interested in maybe their position. And position, of course, can be defined in different ways. Let's say I define it as X and Y coordinate is X coordinate, and C is Y coordinate. So now you're trying to just track those people over time. So A is actually now context, and B and C is behavioral. So in which the case in which behavioral or attributes of interest are spatial, we usually call that trajectory data. Because now you're tracking a point in space, and that tracking itself is of interest to you. Okay. So that tracking is like a trajectory in space. So such data is called trajectory data. For example, let's say if you're monitoring a fleet of Kareem cars, so each car would be a trajectory. There will be multiple cars, of course, and each car would be a trajectory. Such type of data is trajectory data. And here, we do not include the X coordinate and Y coordinate context, X coordinate, Y coordinate, actually the behavioral attributes of interest to us. Okay. So I think that was a bit of introduction. So any questions so far? All right. Okay. So now let's talk about time series data primarily right now. What is the time series data in which the contextual attribute is time and the behavioral attribute is one or more continuous valued attributes. Continuous valued attributes. ठीक है, that is time series data. So we will discuss a number of things which would be similar to what we have studied before. So we will talk about pre-processing, some special considerations for pre-processing time series data. We will then talk about the next topic is time series, and we'll talk about forecasting. ठीक है, forecasting techniques for time series data would be very similar to techniques for regression, or actually they are actually exactly similar to regression. Of course, this would be auto regression. We'll talk about that. We'll then talk about motifs. Motifs are patterns or behavior that occur repeatedly in a time series or multiple time series. So we'll also briefly discuss one or two algorithms for detecting motifs. So maybe some, if you talk about ECG readings of multiple people, there are some patterns that may indicate that the person has a specific heart disease. So to detect those patterns, and if they are occurring frequently, that is called motif detection. ठीक है? We will, after that, we will briefly talk about clustering of time series. Of course, we have already talked about many clustering algorithms. Most of them would be just explained in the sense that how they can be applied to time series data. We will then also again talk about outliers for time series data. ठीक है? And then finally, a little bit about classification for time series data. So many of the techniques that we study here would be somewhat similar. Some would be different, but others would be similar to what we have already studied before. ठीक है? So let's start with some ideas from pre-processing. So time series data typically comes from, let's say, sensors as well. So sensors are usually self-managed, self-operating devices, and they may also have issues periodically, meaning that you might have missing values, meaning that a sensor did not report a value because of various reasons. It could be environmental reasons, it could be other reasons, maybe it has lost power. And there might be other issues of noise and stuff like that. So very quickly, how do we handle missing data, noise in time series data? So let's look at that. So first of all, missing data. So So missing data actually is related to something else as well, but let me talk about that also. So let's say if a particular sensor data is missing, ठीक है? So, or let's say a particular period information is missing. Let's say मेरे पास recording थी, time series है, मेरे पास 25 है, question mark आया, फिर 25 है, फिर 26 है, फिर question mark आया, and so on. एक time series है. So how do you estimate that missing value? And we are assuming that these time recordings are equal intervals. So let's say iska time bhi available. Let me just kind of formulate it more closely. So usually aapke paas koi time series hoti hai, T1 to TN. And corresponding to that time, you have the values X1 to XN. Theek hai? So we have the time for each of those recordings. So if a recording is missing at any point in time, you can estimate it by interpolation. So you can interpolate the missing value. ठीक है? And of course, we have already discussed filling in missing values earlier on as well. But here now, this is a special case where you have a time series. So usually we interpolate based on the time interval between the two. So let's say मेरे पास hours की मैं बात करता हूँ, तो let's say 1 hour पे मेरे पास एक recording थी 25 की, 2 hour पे मेरे पास कोई reading नहीं थी, and then 4 पे मेरे पास एक reading थी let's say 30. ठीक है ना. सो नाउ आई वॉन्ट टू एस्टिमेट अ वैल्यू फॉर द आवर टू. सो आई अज्यूम अ लीनियर बिहेवियर बिटवीन 1 and 4, और 2 पे जो भी वैल्यू एस्टिमेट हो रही है बेस्ड ऑन दैट लीनियर बिहेवियर आई विल फिल इन दैट वैल्यू यूजिंग दैट. सो लीनियर इंटरपोलेशन कर रहे हैं. बट नाउ ऑफकोर्स दिस लीनियर इंटरपोलेशन इज बेस्ड ऑन द टाइम. ठीक है. सो ऑफकोर्स लेट्स से मेरे पास डेटा इस तरह होता, 1 का मेरे पास 25 था, 2 का मेरे पास नहीं था, और 3 का मेरे पास 30 था. नाउ इट्स 2 लाइज इमीडिएटली बिटवीन 1 and 3. तो इसका मतलब है कि बीच वाले का टाइम 27.5 होगा. दिस इज लीनियर इंटरपोलेशन. ऑफ कोर्स आई गेस्ट इट क्विकली, बट प्रीवियसली यू कैन अप्लाई द स्लोप एंड एस्टिमेट इट एग्जैक्टली एज वेल, इन विच इट डजंट अपीयर राइट इन द मिडल. ठीक है. So this is linear interpolation. And linear interpolation can also done for space. So let's say आपके पास x y coordinate पे कोई reading है और एक और x y coordinate पे reading है, ठीक है, और कोई बीच में x y coordinate की reading missing है, तो you can do interpolation. So maybe I can draw this. तो लेट्स से आपके पास इस सेंसर का डेटा है, इसका नहीं है और इसका है. सो हाउ कैन यू एस्टिमेट दिस वैल्यू हियर? सो ऑफ कोर्स यू कैन यूज वेरियस थिंग्स. सो मे बी यू कैन अज्यूम दैट देयर इज अ लीनियर प्लेन बिटवीन दिस एंड दिस वैल्यू, और उसी प्लेन की अप्रोक्सीमेशन को इसकी वैल्यू दे दें. Or you can use more sophisticated triangulation techniques to estimate that missing value. ठीक है ना. So of course triangulation may be linear interpolation ही हो रही, but now you're considering more than 2 points. ठीक है. So that was basically interpolation. One other issue is also important in this context. So let's say you have 2 time series or multiple time series, but the times for those series are not the same. So for example, let's say mere paas 12 hour pe temperature recording thi 25, theek hai, और फिर लेट्स से 13 आवर पे फिर टेम्परेचर रिकॉर्डिंग थी 26, बट आई ऑल्सो हैव स्लाइटली ऑफसेट प्रेशर वैल्यू. लेट्स से प्रेशर वैल्यू लेट्स से 29.9 मर्करी इंच, ठीक है, ओके, एंड देन लेट्स से 13.05, एंड लेट्स से दिस इज 30.0 मर्करी इंच, इंच ऑफ मर्करी. Let's say we want to analyze data at the same time. So you will probably then choose one of those timestamps or dusre ke values aap us pe interpolate kar lenge. So now so you basically then interpolate pressure values at 12 and 13. So that we have synchronized data for both temperature and pressure. ठीक है. This point clear? So this was interpolation. So next thing is actually handling noise. Spending what mistakes are there? Noise, which you can say is smoothing. The usual approach to handle noise is smooth out. So noise often arises due to environmental factors or transmission factors. And this is especially true for sensor data. And of course, noise does cause problems in some algorithms. So we like to smooth out noise or try to remove the noise. Of course, the whole discussion regarding noise and outliers, you already know. Typically, it's not very easy to distinguish between noise and true outliers of interest to us. So, and the techniques that we will be following for smoothing also assume that it is not easy to distinguish between noise and true outliers. Okay, so you need to keep this in mind while you are doing smoothing. So, let's see, time kya hai? 7 ho gaya. Achha. So, okay, so isme do teen techniques, I just mentioned the techniques and we'll talk about them last time. And we have already talked about one or two of them before as well. The first technique is binning. You already know this. The other technique that is more common is the simple moving average. Binning is also sometimes average, but it's average over fixed windows. Moving average is average over sliding windows. And then similar to that is what is known as exponential smoothing. And then, of course, which we won't go into any detail. And for those who are from electrical engineering background, they can know this better. You can also apply discrete wavelet transform, discrete Fourier transform, or discrete cosine transform. And in the transformed space, you can maybe eliminate noise more effectively. Okay. So I will stop here. In the next lecture, we'll briefly talk about exponential smoothing and moving average, and then move on to forecasting. And then after that, we'll talk about motifs and clustering and outliers and classification. Okay. So you get a good idea of how to handle temporal data and more specifically time series data. Any questions? So we will have our last quiz on Monday, inshallah, the coming Monday. So the quiz would, of course, cover the content from the previous quiz, till this lecture. So. So that would be the last quiz, and you will have a N-2 policy. Okay, any other question, or comment or feedback?